So a key aspect of the Cardstack architecture is the idea that we have a rich web tier where in the browser, you know, lots of extremely rich functionality can be packaged up into component form. Lots of different components from different sources and different authors can coexist. We've done a lot of the design footwork and technology footwork to make that possible. And the browser has become such a great general application runtime that that's a really good story. So obviously your data sources can range from, you know, a traditional SQL database like Postgres is an example of a data source. The Ethereum blockchain, right, that could totally be a data source where you might want to store and retrieve stuff. Git is actually really great for all kinds of content, and when you can put a great user experience in front of some of the power of Git, you get a lot of the benefits that developers have that end users don't today in terms of versioning and collaboration. And you know, also even just like fully hosted stuff that if it's the best thing out there or it's what you have to use because you're collaborating with certain other people who are using it, something like Google Calendar, right? I'll just write gcal here, would be another great example of a data source, right? And people suffer because they have all these silos, right? Your stuff in your Google Calendar doesn't know anything about your stuff in your accounting database and your QuickBooks and your, it's not easy to link that up with some smart contract on Ethereum. They're just all very siloed, and applications end up siloed. And so if you want to bring them together, you as the kind of owner of your data really have to be the one running your own personal search engine, right? And that's kind of what the hub tier is designed to be. It's this idea that you can index all the content out of all your data sources into the hub. Our hub tier is a Node.js-based server. And within the hub, kind of as an implementation detail of the hub, is Elasticsearch. And so you have a pretty trusted, battle-tested kind of search engine, the kind of thing that people building ambitious sites would totally use to denormalize data out of a whole bunch of canonical sources into a very fast searchable tier. And what that gives you is that now the interactive stuff going on the device, on the front end, has a really fast standard interface to all your data that doesn't have to care about the back ends, right? So, you know, you can use stuff like JSON API spec as the very standard way that all these cards can talk to your hub. We have standard WebSocket stuff for cards that want to synchronize data and push data to clients. And all that is between the front end and the hub. And it means that your data sources can have radically different speeds, radically different uptimes. As long as we're able to index content into your hub, you can run one search and get really cross-referenced, really powerfully, holistically connected data, even though it comes from many different sources. So a lot of what it takes to do that is having in a classic adapter pattern, having really good plugin capabilities in the hub so that, you know, you can write an adapter that knows how to talk to Postgres, you can have an adapter that knows how to talk to Ethereum, and, you know, it can be packaged up with its own microservices so that you can just say, I would like to add Ethereum to my hub, and now it spins up the necessary microservices to host Geth, right? I wrote PG again twice, I really meant to write ETH. So this would be a plugin provided feature in your hub, right, that now knows how to talk to the actual blockchain. This would be a plugin provided feature that knows to talk to some actual database that you have out there. What's nice about the grand vision here is you can package up full sets of functionality all the way up and down the stack together, right? If you wanted to build some dApp and it's going to use Ethereum for storage, but it needs to actually coexist with the rest of the user's life, right? Like, you don't want to just be a silo. That's not any better than what people have today with siloed proprietary applications. You want they should own their data. They should be able to cross-reference it. Things should be able to persist and move from place to place. So you're going to provide them front-end cards that know how to reflect the data that's part of your application. They can be as sophisticated. You can iterate as fast as you want. It can blow up to full screen. All this kind of stuff. That's the front-end pieces you would provide, right, implemented as components. You'd also provide the plugins that would give them the server-side code they need in their hub to talk out to the data tier. And of course, the data tier itself, maybe there's work to do there too. Maybe there's a smart contract to be deployed. Maybe there's a Postgres database to be created. Maybe there's a Git repo to be created, right? All that stuff. There's different use cases for different classes of data, and your user might want to orchestrate all of those. The point is you can package up all the tiers as a reusable piece. We have a really kind of a well-typed plugin system, as opposed to like a plugins do whatever they want kind of system, which you sometimes see. by making them really well typed, every plugin provides features, and features are there's an enumerated set of possible kinds of features. Some of them are very general and powerful, like a middleware, but others can be much more focused. So for example, to implement a data source, you're going to use some combination of an indexer feature, a writer feature, and a searcher feature. Right? The point being that an indexer is something that can actually incrementally index content out of elsewhere into your own search index. That's the most powerful way to use data, because now you have a local fast cache of everything. And it gives us a lot of power to apply things like authorization rules. Whatever rules you have for that data can be implemented at indexing time. And so even if you have a very rich set of authorization rules, we're able to just denormalize all the facts out into your search index and have very search engine-like experience on the front end where you know, you're not limited by massive table joins and authorization checks and things like that. The writer plugin does what it sounds like, right? It's important to realize that the authoritative home of data is the backends, right? So data that you care about should be on your backends that you own and control. Data that you're trying to integrate with still lives where it's supposed to live. And the hub tier really is a caching tier. So writer plugins don't write to the cache. We don't update our cache fat first. We're going to writer plugins go all the way through the hub out to the authoritative data source, and then the indexers are going to pull that content back in. So we go full round trip. It means you get all the native semantics of the backends, right? If a write to Ethereum is causing things to happen and the smart contract code runs and changes the state, we're going to see that reflected in the index. If the Postgres database is being touched by other code somewhere else, or it's got triggers, like that's going to matter, right? And the searcher is the last feature I mentioned. The searcher lets us handle requests through the hub for things that we don't have in the search index. Locally, we can go do deeper searches for things like, you know, maybe you've decided in your application you're going to outsource identity management to somebody else. Maybe you're going to let users log in with GitHub profiles. In that case, you know, you want to still represent a user in your application. You need that model that represents the user. You don't necessarily want to index every GitHub user into your hub. So in that case, you would just use a searcher. So when you want to refer to user number 123, that request wouldn't hit your own search index. It would go all the way out to the end. That'd be the searcher. So that's the full pattern. And it turns out those three kind of well-typed plugins that you would write are enough to do vastly different backends. And all these patterns come out of hard-won experience from having built this kind of application many, many times over. You know, I think something that's nice about the Cardstack architecture here is that all the individual pieces are actually not radically different than what experienced teams are building today. I think what's unique about it is the goal of being able to package this stuff up and have a whole open ecosystem using this stuff all at once together.